Good evening. I am so thrilled to be introducing Beethoven's Ninth Symphony to you. Raise your hands if this is the first time you have seen this symphony performed live. Oh, good. Oh, you are in for such a treat. I am never going to forget my first performance. It's like one of those things, that one of your firsts, your great firsts. And I was 13 years old, and my response was I sat through, you know, about an hour's worth of music with this huge chorus, and these bleachers are going to be filled with a choir, and these four singers on stage, utterly silent, and I thought, what is happening? All these people are so quiet, hundreds of people not doing anything. And then there's this moment where everybody stands up, and I swear to this day, I can feel the goosebumps on my arm with that moment. It truly is a magical, magical experience. And what Beethoven gives us in this symphony is he really gives us an extraordinary gift. He expands what a symphony was thought possible to be. In Bach's time, a standard orchestra could consist of 12 musicians on stage. Mozart and Haydn wrote in general for a force of 20 musicians. Someone out there no doubt will be counting how many chairs we have here. But when you combine those forces of the orchestra plus the choir, which had never, ever been done in a symphony orchestra, plus the soloists, you're talking about an expansion of size and sound that was simply unimaginable in the 18th century. Simply unimaginable. And Beethoven also takes us on a dynamic journey. The thunderous sounds that we're going to hear shook the concert hall of Vienna, and they might shake the concert hall here tonight as well. And he stretches us even more emotionally. We are going to go on an odyssey tonight. And what I invite you to consider this evening to be is not just what some people have suggested is the greatest symphony ever written, the greatest orchestral piece ever written. What it really is, it's a profound journey into the very question of what does it mean to be human? What does it mean to be human? And Beethoven gives us this absolutely profound glimpse of the possibility of hope in humanity. And in his own life, this was something he desperately longed for. And it's something that he found, a profound universality that I think we all long for, especially in the events of the past few weeks, especially in those. So the journey that we're going to go on, if I were to subtitle it, I would call it the journey from despair to hope, the journey from violent conflict to reconciliation, and his own personal motto, the journey from anguish to joy, which is something he wrote about again and again and again in his diaries. Now, as no doubt some of you know, Beethoven had one of the most horrific childhoods we know of any composer and artist. He had a father who was deeply, deeply violent and alcoholic, a mother who was suffering from terrible pain and illness. And as a child, his father had dreams of turning him into a little Mozart, a child prodigy that he would parade across the stage. So Beethoven began his relationship with music actually from a place of terror. There are neighborhood accounts of his father coming home drunk and shaking the little boy when he was 6 or 7 years old awake in the middle of the night and dragging him to the piano and saying, "You have to practice." And Beethoven sitting there with tears pouring down his little face, playing until dawn. And when he made mistakes or he did things that his father didn't like, and some people have even suggested that that might be a cause for his deafness. Over and over. When he disobeyed his father, he would be locked in the cellar overnight. Of course, in Sonoma County, we would call Child Protective Services. This didn't happen for Beethoven. What happened for Beethoven is that he took all of the pain and the rage and the grief that was in his heart and in his life, and he poured it into his music, and music became his lifeline. Became his lifeline. Before Beethoven, music was thought of as entertainment, something that would delight and amuse the audience. But in Beethoven's musical autobiography, he expands the whole point of music, that music isn't here to entertain us, it's actually to put us in touch with the deepest aspects of our human existence. And it's what ripped people open, and there are these wonderful images, these lithographs from Beethoven's time of him playing at the piano. And there are people who are sitting there, back in the chair, or like this, because they couldn't believe how they were struck emotionally with the power of what Beethoven was creating. It was a form of autobiography that I believe saved his life. He left Bonn, he left his abusive childhood, and he went off to the city of Vienna, the city of Haydn and Mozart. Mozart, whom he idolized. Haydn, who he had a very challenging relationship as a student with. Haydn was very much of the previous century about order and form and politeness in his music. And Beethoven just had to express what was in his heart. And sometimes what he expressed in his heart was not very polite. And his music is filled with that kind of power that was thought to be rather indecorous at the time. Things that people didn't say in polite conversation, Beethoven said with his music. He poured it all inside of that. Now, in the course of his life, musicologists have often talked about there being three distinct periods in his musical development. The first is where he is imitating Haydn and Mozart. And he does it rather awkwardly because he still has to be him, and he does it with more power and force, in particular with more sforzandi, these sudden sharp accents that sometimes feel a little bit like the musical equivalent of Tourette syndrome. With these sudden violent outbursts. But by and large, the music from the first part of his compositional development up until around the age of 30 follows this imitative path. And then, as his deafness descended upon him and as he retreated from the world around into an inward landscape and was filled with that sense of confrontation, musicologists call the second period often the heroic period of music, and we get the Eroica Symphony and works like the Emperor Piano Concerto and the Fifth Symphony, pieces of music that really are about titanic struggle. And we hear in that music this anguish and this battle to the death. If you think, know, those of you who know the Fifth Symphony, it begins yabababam with a shake of fists in the key of C minor, this tragic key. But it ends in triumph, this blaze of glory. And I almost want to put in subtitles the words at the end, because the end of the Fifth Symphony has this extended cadence that goes on and on and on and on. And it's like he's saying, I won, 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 I won. And it just goes on and on and on forever, right? And so musicologists talk about this as being the heroic period, and it really parallels much of what the great mythologist Joseph Campbell talks about, that the first half of our journey is this journey where we're struggling on the road of trials, where we're asserting our individuality, where we're encountering things that really make us in the struggle, and if we're lucky, we emerge victorious. But both Joseph Campbell and the great Swiss psychologist Carl Jung suggest that there's also a second part of the hero's journey. And if the first part is overcoming and succeeding and triumphing against adversity, the second half of life, the later part of life, is actually about the journey inward. And rather than triumphing against all odds, the invitation in the latter part of our life is actually to surrender to something that is larger than we are. And rather than heroically fighting to the finish, the gesture is this. Here. Here is my heart. Here is my truth. Here. It's what the great poet T.S. Eliot described as a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything. Oh, you like that. I'll say it again. A condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything. Now, as Beethoven wrote this symphony, one of the things that he carried with him was something from his youth. He had a poem that he adored from the time he was a teenager. And he told his friends in his city of Bonn, someday, I'm going to set that poem to music. And that poem is the basis of this Ode to Joy. It's a hymn of universal brotherhood. And it has a lot of fascinating layers to it. And Beethoven took it and carried it with him all through his heroic conquest. And in his twilight years, at that time our lifespans were not so long, but he was in his 50s, he thought of writing a new symphony. And at first he thought of writing two different symphonies. He was going to write one that he called a pagan symphony that would have a sense of the whirlwind of Bacchus in it, a bacchanalia, a festive, ecstatic piece of music. And the second symphony that he would write, he called the Christian symphony. And the Christian symphony would have it as its conclusion, a great finale that was a hymn based on Bach's name, B-A-C-H, because H in German is a B flat. So he would weave Bach's name throughout this. And he sat for a number of years, the pagan symphony, the Christian symphony, the pagan symphony, the Christian symphony, thinking about these two. Ultimately, what he came to was he combined those two ideas together in the work that we're going to hear tonight. And the way that he found that bridge and that link was through the poem that he had cherished since childhood. Now, raise your hands if we have some good church-going folks out there who have opened up your hymnals to sing, "Joyful, joyful, we adore thee." Oh, look at all those hands go up. And this is a hymn we sing proudly in churches, in Lutheran churches, in Episcopal churches, in Catholic churches, all over, a good Christian hymn. There's only one problem with that, folks. And the problem is that the Ode to Joy is actually a pagan drinking song to the god Bacchus. And if you read the poem very closely and you follow all of the references, it's very dense with, replete with references, but there are all kinds of lines about drinking. Let's raise a toast. Let's raise this. And there's this reference of a line that keeps coming back over and over and over again. Joy, daughter of Elysium, daughter of Elysium. Now, I didn't know this until I was a graduate student in mythology, but as I investigated what the heck this joy daughter of Elysium is, it was a reference to the Eleusinian mysteries and the Orphic mystery religions, which was an initiation into the mythology that included Bacchus, also known as Dionysus, with references to the whole Greek myth of Persephone going down into the underworld and then coming back up. And the daughter of Elysium is actually Joy, the daughter of Psyche, who goes to the underworld in her travels to meet up with Persephone. So there's so much to the backstory of this. So one of the things that this symphony is it's a profound reconciliation of seeming paradoxes, the pagan and the Christian. And he puts that all together in this cry for universal brotherhood. Alle Menschen werden Brüder. When I heard that for the first time, I didn't know German. I thought they were singing, all the munchkins, all the munchkins, all the munchkins. I was 13, you can forgive me. Alle Menschen werden Brüder, all mankind are brothers. And what Beethoven does in this symphony, in addition to harmonizing all of these opposites, these things that shouldn't go together, the Christian and the pagan, the orchestra and the chorus, those were two very separate things, and he brings them together. But in addition to reconciling those paradoxes, he uses the Ninth Symphony as a life review, as an opportunity to go back over his life. And we know this because in the notes, he took extensive notes, and we have wonderful notebooks as he's sketching out the symphony. And in part of the sketches, what we can see is that he draws inside the symphony things that only he would have been aware of. Our ears aren't going to catch them. But he knew. He knew, for example, that in one of the movements, the cellos and the basses are actually playing the theme from the slow movement melody of the Pathetique Sonata. and that he quotes from the Second Symphony, and that there are little fragments buried in the layers of this orchestra of other moments that were significant to him in his musical compositional life. It's as if he has a photograph album. Oh, remember this. Oh, remember the Sonata Opus 13. Oh, remember this. And it's all woven in. And then what he takes us on is this magnificent journey. And it's a journey that is the story of his life, the journey from terror to triumph to surrender. So our first movement, or the first movement that we're going to listen to of the Ninth Symphony, begins with this haunting, strange little sound. It's not in the wrong key. We have an A and E, and the symphony is in D minor, so this sense of unease. Before we get these fiery, tempestuous chords, this terrifying descent, it's music actually that is intended to terrify us, the way that I imagine Beethoven as a small child was terrified. And when my daughter was little, I put on different kinds of music, and the first time I put on the symphony, this little baby arched her back and screamed, ah! She got it. She got what he was getting at. It is really music that is intended to terrify us. And then some people have suggested that what we encounter is actually the death of the hero, the heroic death. There's a death march, a funeral march that we'll encounter in this somber, dark, fearful, terrifying. The second movement, and in many ways, is its antithesis, because it's got this infectious rhythm, and I imagine many of you are going to leave still with this perpetual motion, yum ba dum ba dum, in your mind. It is a dance, a whirlwind. Some musicologists have seen in this a denial of death and a turning your back on it. Others have seen it as a tarantella, a dance of death, or a demonic dance. It's so fast and so furious. And we have throughout the kettle drums, the timpani over here, ba-ba-da-dum, ba-ba-da-dum, and they're staggered, not quite in the beats that you expect, which was one of his signal marks of humor in much of his music and his heroic period as well. And after that tarantella-like figure of this scherzo, this whirlwind dance, then we enter into the third movement, which represents his third compositional period. He writes very soft and very slow. And in some ways, it's intended as a lullaby, music in which you are just here, here. And then he spins it out in these endless variations of tenderness throughout. So it's a beautiful encapsulation of his own musical journey from terror to heroism to manic energy. And that second movement has that feeling of the bacchanalian frenzy. And some people have referred to it as a drunken frenzy. I would just remind us that for Beethoven, a drunken frenzy had some very painful consequences in his life as well, so the darkness. But then that sweet, sweet, sweet moment, the transcendent moment. And then comes something that has puzzled so many people because it didn't exist. And there's not really a musical way to understand this, but there is a story behind it that I think helps us understand what happens. In Beethoven's library, towards the end of his life, it was a fascinating library. He had works of Eastern philosophy. He had works of Hinduism. He had all kinds of fascinating texts. And he was very drawn to both the tragedies and the mythology of ancient Greece. Now, if you've seen a Greek tragedy on stage, you know that there's the action in which the actors are speaking. They were originally singing in ancient Greece. And there's the chorus, which is what we get our word for the musical part of the ensemble that sings. But the function of the Greek chorus is actually to comment on what is happening on stage, to actually provide a moral voice, to warn, to chide, to encourage, to be the running commentary. And at the end of the third movement, we have the introduction of a Greek chorus into our orchestra. So we will have this terrifying descent, this what has been called a primal scream. Do you all know that Munch painting? It's the musical equivalent of that, in which we have a D minor chord and a B flat chord superimposed upon each other as they plummet down to the depths of hell. And then we have an ensemble, you'll hear it over here, that's the cellos, and they form the Greek chorus. And we know what Beethoven intended because he writes this in his notebooks. He writes, no, 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 not those sounds. And that's what the cellos are supposed to be playing. And then the orchestra recapitulates everything that's happened up until then. So they say, well, how about this? And they play the beginning of the first movement again, just a little snatch of the opening of the first movement. And the cellos interrupt, and they have this sense that's as if, no, 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 we're not going to do that again either. And so then the orchestra then turns and says, well, how about the second movement? And the orchestra, once again, the Greek chorus says, mm-mm-mm, that's not where we're going to go. So then they offer the beginning, the theme of the third movement, the slow movement. And this is so beautiful that the cellos have to pause and consider and say, well, that's that maybe, but ultimately they decide that they can't go there either. That rather than all of the musical pathways Beethoven has traversed in his life, something new is called for, something beyond. And it's at that moment that we get the introduction of the Ode to Joy theme. How about this? Dum bum be dum. And the cellos rejoice. Yes, 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 he's got it. So I want to play this little moment, this musical peculiarity that makes perfect sense if you're seeing this as both a life review and a psychological drama with the understanding of the Greek chorus. Final screen. No. First movement theme. No, we are not going down that path anymore. Well, then what about this theme from the second movement? That is no better than the first. What about this? Oh, that's good. Maybe. Starting in the lowest strings, we have this theme. And oh, this theme has so much significance. There's all this hidden symbolism about the number four in Orphism, but that's another lecture. And after we hear this, then, in these low strings, then there comes this beautiful moment where we start to rise. Oh, rising towards the light. I hate cutting that off, and the only reason I can live with myself is you're gonna hear it. And Beethoven takes us through this theme four times then, adding in instrument family after instrument family, growing from this soft hush introduction to a more complex introduction with all the instruments louder and louder, more and more joyous. Now I have to say one word about this theme. It's not as easy to write a catchy folk song as you might think. And Beethoven labored because he really wanted something that was accessible to everyone. And as all of us know, we can sing this, even those of us who can't sing well, if we go to church, or we go to a little violin recital and we hear students in their first or second year sawing away on this. He wanted it simple on purpose. Because what he does then from this little seed germ, this is the essence of what it is to be human. And then he takes us through every possible variation he can. And some of those variations really have puzzled people throughout the times, because we will have all these transcendent celestial hymn treatment of this tune. And we're also going to have something that has been described as a ridiculous little ditty with a Turkish march in there. And they're side by side. We have the most complex form in music, a double fugue. And then we have this thing that sounds like a little military band going down the parade of Petaluma. And this juxtaposition, back and forth, things that shouldn't go together are side by side. And for me, how I've come to understand this is that it is Beethoven's way of saying yes to the entire journey of what it means to be human. That Beethoven says, being human isn't just about the pretty stuff. It isn't just about the beauty. And yes, there are moments of transcendence, but there are moments in all of our lives of absolute agony. And there are moments where we are ridiculous. And there are moments where we feel shame. And there are moments that are banal. And then there are moments of ecstasy. And it's his benediction of the entire journey. The entire journey. And I think we all know this at some level. Even if we haven't thought it, we feel it. When we leave the Ninth Symphony, our heart is cracked open. We are bigger. He has stretched us somehow. If I had one wish about going back in time, I would go to Beethoven in the last years of his life, the man who was an abused child, the man who was rejected and laughed at by every single woman he proposed marriage to as being ugly and half crazy, the man who lived with physical infirmity, not just of his ears, but he had horrific intestinal problems, died of cirrhosis of the liver, physical agony, the likes of which very few of us will ever experience. The man who felt so profoundly alone. And when he performed this symphony, he was on stage waving, but he couldn't hear a note of it. And so the orchestra finished before he knew they were done, and the soprano soloist took and turned for him to see the audience, because he couldn't hear the deafening sound of their applause as they stood. He could see, though, he could see the tears on their faces, and he could see what the music had done to them and how it had connected to their humanity. And if I could go to Beethoven, I would go to him in his last years of his life, and I would show him that he really did achieve what he wanted, that he created out of this symphony a universal song of brotherhood, that time and time and time again, when humanity is in its darkest hours, it turns to as a pathway of light and hope. I would show him the German prison camps and the Jewish prisoners that were in there as they were playing Ode to Joy on their instruments. I would take him to Berlin when the wall fell down, because what was played was the Ode to Joy. I would take him to Tiananmen Square as the Chinese soldiers sat there facing the tanks, and on their boom boxes was the Ninth Symphony. And I would show him all around the world, including here in Sonoma County, after 9/11, when our response to the tragedy and terror of the worst parts of what humankind does to each other, the response all around the world was one answer. We have to sing the Ninth Symphony. We have to remember all humankind are brothers. The end of the symphony ends with this beautiful line of, part of the line is, all men are brothers. This kiss is for the whole world. There's a line in something called the Gospel of Thomas, scriptures which were found in Nag Hammadi, Egypt in 1945, that date back to the first century of Christianity. There's this line that says, if you bring forth what is in you will save you. If you don't bring forth what is in you will destroy you. For me, Beethoven is the great teacher. He took everything in his life, his abuse, his pain, his grief, his sorrow, and he poured it into the ink, his blood, sweat, and tears that he used to write the Ninth Symphony. And in so doing, he gave a kiss to all of us. And tonight we get to kiss him back. I am Dr. Kayleen Asbo, and as you might have guessed, I am madly, madly in love with this short, smelly, ugly, disheveled, deaf man. And I have a series that's ongoing, and perhaps you might want to join me on Beethoven and the Hero's Journey. Our ushers have cards as you leave if you'd like to join me at the Petaluma Historical Museum or online at my website. And tonight, I invite you into the great celebration and that consideration of how can we respond in this time of darkness and tragedy? How can we bring forth the hope and the joy that is inside each one of us? Not to write a symphony, perhaps, but maybe a poem or a letter or paint a painting, or just to give the best that we have in us to all humanity who are our brothers and sisters. Thank you.